And we find ourselves in game number one, the second series of the day, the Viper versus Boros. We're trying to catch up. This is Nomad. And yeah, if anybody has any issues with the colors as they are, do let me know. We can change the Viper over to the red color, but right now we are going to keep blue and yellow. As always, opting for the default colors until anybody complains. Regardless, I guess Vita's audience, have they really seen the set? No, if the sets are not played live, they cannot stream their point of view. The only way you can stream your point of view is if you play your series live. Otherwise, it's gotta be privately played, and then it's going to be cast with Record the Games for the first time. So, in high school at 16, then 16 to 18 is like post-high school education. You don't have to do it, right? Interesting. Whoa! Stuart Cheadle, thank you so much for gifting the sub to Jade Arrow Gamer. It's very much appreciated, and welcome to the club, Jade. And another sub! Wow! Stuart, thank you so much for the support. Two gifted subs. Love to see it. It's very much appreciated. I didn't know that. I guess Vita's audience are just quiet after all. Yeah. And another one! Stuart! Man! Thank you so much for the support. Three gifted subs back to back. Look at this Stuart, man. Look at him. Yes. Thank you so much for the support. It's very much appreciated. Three gifted subs coming in back to back. Welcome to the club. You guys. Smiley AOE. In addition to Emalfado, hopefully I'm saying that correctly, it's very much appreciated. And there's a fourth gifted sub as well. My lord, Stuart, you legend. Thank you so much for the support and welcome, Hermetica Clan as well, to the club. It's fantastic. We have a gift train, yes. There's one thing that I did not do though, and that is say thanks to Stuart for the fifth gifted sub. Lucky, welcome to the club as well. Damn, Stuart. That is a lot of support. Are you coming from the raid? Or were you already lurking from before? Let me check this out real quickly. I'm just going to fix this. I didn't do it before, but like to have the flags and ideally remove any clan prefixes. And Boros is Polish, right? If I'm not mistaken. That is a lot of subs. Team Hermetica, let's go! We have a big community all over the world, friendly people who love Age of Empires, let's go. Yes! We're streaming in English or Spanish, by the way, Hermetica. VOH is here for both these players. We haven't really gotten around talking about the civilizations too much yet. English! I see. Alright. My language we speak is English, but people from everywhere. Right. We're a global community, so we speak English. Hermetica Clan. Right. You know, Hermetica would have me thinking, the Argentinian band. I don't know if that's the source for the name, or if it's a different origin. Regardless though, Boros is playing a significantly different game compared to the Viper here. He's playing for a fast castle. He's playing with Spanish, it makes sense. So he's gonna try and make a play for Conquistador as well, the Viper. With Malians, he's playing for a standard feudal where he's gonna start going for some navy units and he'll try to get full water control. And Boros, once he gets to the castle age, of course, he's already collecting stone quite heavily. He'll drop a castle and he'll try to put pressure up with Conquistadors. This is an all-in kind of strategy that we are seeing from Boros that I have seen so many times on Nomad, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It's not a surefire way of taking the game for sure. It certainly does entail a few risks. And the Viper, on the other hand, by playing a standard fuel time over here is going to end up taking all the fish and ships down, most likely, from Bars. Yeah. I wonder if the high-level players hate playing against Spanish as much as lower level do. They probably do, but they are probably a little bit more effective at countering it, and we'll see if the Viper is able to clutch it up over here. If he does end up getting full water control, his economy is going to be so much stronger compared to Bars's. All he's going to need to do is protect himself to make sure that the Conquistadors can come in freely and start raiding, right? So, the yellow players should try to rush the Castle H as much as he can so that he can get access to Monks and he can defend himself. He does have, however, a forward villager that is going for a forward archer range, and we'll see some skirmishers come out as soon as he finishes building that one. Of course, that will come at the expense of going out to the Castle H significantly later, but because he will have all the water control, he should still have a much stronger economy by the time he eventually gets out to the Castle Age. I'm going out for dinner. Hopefully catch you in one of our streams, dude. GG's. Much love. Thank you so much. It's appreciated. I imagine if anything, they'd prefer it because it's a bit more predictable. If anything seems to tell the pro, it's something unpredictable and messy, probably, right? And check this out, the Viper's got one archer. He's going for the second archer. He was going for the second archer, he actually cancelled it. And he's just going to delay this castle a little bit, but it's not going to be by too much. Remember that the Spanish for Bars, even though we didn't really talk about it too much, they will get 32% faster working builders. Here we go, Gus comes up, and the Viper is still trying to get some damage done over here. Give me a villager, man! Don't be like that, come on. Just one villager, nope. Okay. So as expected, the Viper is going up to the Castle H, and we see the walls come in for the yellow player already, so it's gonna get the walls up over here, which means that if Bars is to ever come in, he's gonna need to get probably a jock up over here, I would imagine. Get a transport ship. Then get the units over to the other side, perhaps. We know the Bars is not going for the second DC right away. Going for the Conquistadors over here, going for the castle, and the Conquistadors is going to be too pricey for him to go for much of anything else, but I guess he's just gonna try and batter through the walls over here, try to destroy the walls. And the Viper, beautiful reaction, check this out! Amazing. But here comes Bars though! With a petard! He's coming in! The walls do not have any armor! So here he comes. Yes, sir. The Conquistadors are about to break in. Now Bars, he's getting access to the Viper's economy. So the yellow player is trying to go for the monasteries we were talking about earlier, right? If he manages to get some monks out, that should be really good. However, Bars is bringing some monks himself as well. At the very least one. But he does have another one queued up. Siege workshop as well. This is a lot of pressure coming in from Bars. And the great thing about the bull player's position is that now by coming in, he can just station the Conquistadors here, the Conquistadors over here, push the villagers away from wood. And you can see the Viper is kind of forced into a second TC elsewhere. And that's going to buy him some time, of course. His economy is going to be alright, but Bars, if he plays his cards right, might actually be able to take the TC down over here very, very soon, and then he'll be able to move over to the second TC. However, he's gotta be careful. We see extra gates coming up for the Viper. The quick walls are coming in just in time. The conversion is coming up as well. The Conquistador is being microed a little bit too late, but because of the poor RNG for the Viper, Bars is able to walk away over here unconverted. Beautiful. Mangled on the way already, and where's the monk from the blue player? He had it. I'm not really sure. Well, the Viper, he should try and get redemption, right? The Malians do get it, so he would be able to get the mangle over here. Supreme Commander camera. There's a bunch of little casting tools like that. Not going to lie, that drone stuff is cool. Nice, you like it. Ah, oh, the monk took a relic. So he's bringing it back now. Right, where's the monk? Yeah, he probably brought it back. Not really sure exactly where the second one is. He's probably collecting relics around the map. But yeah, anyway. This is some great pressure from Bars. The second. Mangonel is coming out. And the Viper. The Viper is likely going to end up losing this. Need to show them the zoom cam too? Ah, there's going to be time for that. Redemption would actually be really nice since Bars is likely to add in more mangoes. Basically, no one makes a workshop for just one or two. Yeah! And he kind of has to, right? The Conquistadors on their own are not going to be enough. So there we go! The Viper's got Redemption! He's going for Sanctity right now! And here come the Conquistadors, and check that retarget! He was able to get the Conquistador pretty much instantly. And not only that, he takes one of the monks from Bars down with the Converted Conquistador before he manages to successfully delete it and prevent Bars from converting it back. So now there's a castle drop coming in from Bars. It still has a lot of pressure coming up. But it's gotta be careful. The castle coming up is certainly higher priority than trying to take the TC down right away with the Mangonels, especially when there is a risk. The Viper might end up converting the Mangonels and the Danae in the castle here from Bars with the converted Mangonels, right? So it's gotta be wary. Pressure from Bars is fantastic. Sticking villagers down. The Viper is going to call it GG! With a single G! You can see the yellow player must not be too happy about this. The villagers going down. The Mantle, of course, was going to end up taking the TC down. And yeah, the pressure from Bars does actually work out over here very nicely. Finds himself on a 1-0 lead against the snake, the Viper, the goat, begins his series on the left foot. And let's go through the achievements before jumping into game number two. There will be some spec delay probably for the second game, but we are still just going to get the commercial out of the way right away. Better kitty for the Viper, yes, and that was not the best for Bars considering the price of the units he was going for. This KD certainly gives the Viper a much higher value in military traits compared to Bars. For economy, we have a stronger economy for the Viper, collecting about 1,300 extra resources or so on top of what Bars was able to collect. But it was not about economy over here, it was all about the pressure, and Bars was able to clutch it up. Not a good day for GL. Yeah, this is not the best start for the Viper this series, of course, but he does have still two chances at the series. And game number two is going to take place on Viper's home map. He has chosen Arabia. Let's go back and take a look at the draft. And here we are, everyone. Game number two. The Viper down 1 point against Bars. He's gonna play Hindustanis this time around. Bars, on the other hand, he does have Lithuanians. Not really sure if he was expecting to be fighting against Mayans, but yeah, now the Viper, actually not in a poor position because of it. It's looking pretty alright. Taking a look at the civilization before moving on to the map generation, we'll see Bars with Lithuanians will get 150 extra food upon start of the game, in addition to 10% fast movement skirm and spearline units. We also have for Lithuanians one extra attack on Knights and Light Chaper, each relic garrison up to 4 relics, so at the plus 4 attack, and for the team bonus, 20% faster work in monasteries. The Viper, playing with the Hindustanis, will get 25% faster attacking camel units. In addition to plus 1 armor on gunpowder units, the Hindustanis also get a fantastic discount on villagers of 10, 15, 20, and 25% cheaper villas in the Dark, Feudal, Castle, and Imperial Age, respectively. Finally, for the team bonus, the Viper will have 2 bonus damage against buildings from Camel Rider units like Avery and Hazar. So moving on to map generation, Varus is very, very close to the corner of the map, so this is actually very good for him. We'll see that he's got the main goal on the back. He's got the secondary goals, both of these up in the north, very far away. However, because he's kind of close to the corner of the map, if he went for some walls like this or so, he should be able to secure not only this goal, but potentially this goal as well. The stones, on the other hand, these will be a little bit more exposed. Both the main and secondary ones will be forward. And interestingly enough, it seems like Bars is going to try to connect the walls around his TC as opposed to towards the TC. And yeah, the stones will be a little bit too far away, right? But the gold's going to be fine. The wall line's going to be fine if he does end up going for walls like this. And because he's so close to the corner of the map, this is something that he should definitely be considering going for. The Viper, on the other hand, he does have the mingled forward, so compared to the bull player, this is not quite as nice for him. And then the secondary goal is going to be towards the right-hand side, one up in the north, and the other one extremely far to the right. While for stone, we'll see the main stone forward as well, and the Viper hacks are actually not working correctly for this game, because this map generation is not good. It's not good. Well, he might be able to secure the wall line by going for some walls from here to here, here towards the DC. He'll be able to secure this one. He would have to go for some very pricey walls around the left-hand side if he wants to secure this one. Otherwise, going for something like this is going to be cheaper, of course. But doesn't really secure anything, right? Like, what does the Viper get from going for walls like this? No, it's got to be something else. He is also kind of close to the corner of the map, so he could try and make a play for the walls like this. That is going to be significantly harder to defend, especially the area around here, which is just too far away from any villagers that the Viper is going to have to work with, right? So if he were to go for something like this, ideally he would want to go for houses over here as opposed to just palisades. Regardless though, even if he went for the walls like this, he would be able to secure the wood line, but he would not be able to secure any of the golds, he would not be able to secure any of the stones, and overall, this map generation for the Viper is not respecting the map hacks that the Snake has become so famous for, in part. So I think Viper's map is nice. A castle on top of the hill in front of him, and he's fine. Yeah, I mean, you have to get to the castle age, right? For that, what happens if he gets completely pushed away from resource in the fuel age? Like, Bars could come over. And we could see from, imagine one tower over here from the bull player, hedonize the stone and the gold. Another one over here, hedonize the gold and the wood. And then another one over here, oops, that is not good. And then another one over here, and hedonize both these as well, right? Like, three locations. And the Viper's out of resources. He would have still access to wood, but that's about it. I guess we'll find out though. Bars, he is getting some scouting information around Viper's base, and he knows about the stone, he knows about the main gold, but he doesn't know about the secondary golds yet. He doesn't know about the secondary stone either. He's about to find out about that one though, I think. Probably. Should he use the cliffs for walls? I feel like that might be a little bit too far away. Well, that would certainly protect the gold and the stones, right? But maybe a little bit too far away for him to effectively protect it. We'll see. For the time being, the Viper has gone for the walls up in the north, and he still has not decided how to wall the left-hand side. Very much open over there for the time being. Boss, he's getting to the fuel age. He's coming in with Spearman. He's got scouts on the way. And the Viper, he gets to the fuel age, and he goes for a stable himself, so he's going up on a stronger economy. Going up later means that Bars is going to offset for the defense advantage of the Viper by getting access to scout production significantly earlier. Huh. Bars knows about Viper's goal north of his wood. He did not know last time that I checked about any of the secondary goals, actually. And he still doesn't. And this one? He actually missed by one tile. How unlucky. Here he comes. The scouts, the Viper. Is not getting the walls up on time! So we might see a village go down over there. Notice the boss is trying to bait the villagers away from the choke point over there. Not to get trapped or potentially surrounded. And he does play his cards right though. Boss is extremely cautious. He's just going to bail. He's got 3 scouts total. The Viper is going for the 4th scout. Is Boss just going to try to play for the castle edge here? He's going for extra spearmen and no additional units. I think he's probably not feeling too confident against... Yeah, Viper's defense is over here. So he's just going to try and play for the castle edge and stop going for any extra military units. Just defensive ones if he needs to. The spearmen. Right hand side, Boss is still very much open. It's going for extra walls up in the north, though. If he knows he has all the gold tonight, it's so good for him. Yeah, he didn't really get the scouting that he needed, though, although the scouts came over. Oh, check this out, though! Now he knows about the golds. Now he knows about the stones as well, and here comes Boss, straight up against the spearman. He doesn't have losing the scout. Trying to get a village down over here. He got it down to very low HP. In the end, the villager is walking away with 4 HP. Taking a look at the next target from Boss. We'll see if the Viper doesn't have losing a villager or not so far. It's been better for the Viper in terms of trades. 2 Neil KD. Just scouts going down. And then on the right hand side, the Viper was trying to put some pressure himself, but he was unable to come in. Boss is in a good spot. He's going to get the walls up over here. Connecting the wool lines, which means he won't really be secure in the wool lines by going for the walls from here to here that I was describing earlier, but he will still be able to secure this goal, which is fantastic. He will still be able to keep himself safe, which is going to give him peace of mind, of course. And Boss still has both these scouts alive. Very low HP, mind you. 50% HP. And the Viper's actually getting a first Eco Blah. The villager crumbles right there from Boss. But of course, hey, check it out. Boss is actually gonna try to connect the wood lines the way that I was suggesting. This is so much better. It's gonna be a little bit harder to defend. Once again, you might want to consider going for a few houses behind the palisades over there, but for the time being, it's not too bad. However, the Viper's over here. Boss is trying to bring the spearman over. It's going to be a single spearman against 5 scouts, and the villager is getting quick wall right now because Boss recognizes a single spearman is not going to suffice, so he does bring a second one. It seems like he should be able to finish getting the walls up. Yes, Boss. He's going to end up losing yet another villager. But the walls will come up in the end. Or at least they should, right? Once the Viper manages to surround the villager over here and get it down anyway. It's going to try to. The spearmen are there. Viper's got to respect that, and he's going to. So Boss will end up getting the walls up over here. It did come at the cost of 2 villagers going down. However, he also has saved resources by not going for any extra scouts compared to the Viper. And he should be on his way to the castle edge very soon. Viper's bringing archers over. Does not give you some time to deny the walls. But still. Oh! Boss almost lets the Viper in. But yeah, still the castle edge should be on the way for both these players at about the same time. Here we are. Castle H on the way for the Viper. Castle H on the way for Boss. At the very least, now Boss is completely aware of the resource location for the Viper. And interestingly enough, it seems like the yellow player is going to try to wall towards the edge of the map. Okay. You know, he is the one putting pressure here. So he doesn't need to worry about Boss all of a sudden showing up with a bunch of scouts, right? He is not really expecting much of anything from Boss. Until the players get to the castle edge, and even then, because the Viper is the one putting pressure for the most part, we might actually just see extra TCs coming for Boss. Well, he doesn't really have the stone to go for two additional TCs. He doesn't really have the wood to go for the extra TCs either. Castle Age is here for both these players about the same time. Crystal Man blocking our upgrades. Not really here for the Viper. A lot of danger for Barus. The Viper started this one on the left foot. Game number one going in favor of Barus, of course. But now, in game number two, he is looking extremely dominant. Against Philly Chinos, he doesn't really care too much what these skirmishers might or might not be able to do. Barus does get the Elite Skirmisher upgrade, mind you, and he's got Leather Arch Armor coming up, which is going to make these so much more effective against the Necrosis and the Viper by losing the Scouts. Doesn't that get him pushed away from here? But Barus should be already completely stabilized, right? He's got a Defensive Siege Workshop, he's going to close the gap over here, and it's going to be completely walled off once again. However, he finds himself in an awkward spot. He doesn't have any extra TCs coming up, so he's not playing for economy, and the little military that he does have is not good to fight the Viper. Of the Viper is going for the second and third TCs instead with a 20% discount. He gets some villagers already in the Castle Age. The Viper is going to start pulling ahead for very cheap. And Barus is kind of in a position where he needs to go for one TC full push over here. But because he was the one under the most pressure in the Fuel Age, he transitioned into the Castle Age with mostly defensive units, and you can see the skirmishers are going down. Not quite. Kamel gets taken down by the spearman, but still, only 5 skirmishers for Barus over here. What is he ever going to do forward? And unfortunately, because he was under pressure and he was forced into a defensive siege workshop, Barus doesn't even have the infrastructure forward that he needs to start putting pressure against the Viper's TCs, right? So by the time the Wu player gathers his forces together and sends those forward, the Viper's already going to get such a nasty villager lead, the Barus. It's going to struggle big time to get any damage done. The Viper on the second and third TCs. Already. Has been training villagers non-stop. Meanwhile, Barus still does not go for the second TC. Now he's going to. But this is, of course, a drop in the bucket. The Viper still has one additional TC compared to Barus, who is not collecting any stone. And does not seem to be interested in going for any extra economy, so I'm not liking this from Barus. I gotta be honest, on the right-hand side, we see the second TC come up. Barus, in my opinion, needed to stick to one TC and go for full push. The problem, though, is he was stuck in a defensive position when transitioning over to the Castle Age, right? But so it was not going to be easy, obviously. He was still going to struggle to get any damage down against the Viper, but by going for the second TC over here, he kind of... he's going to half-heartedly go for economy, half-heartedly go for a push. He's got skirmishers only. Obviously, that's not going to do anything. And the Viper's going for a 4 TC, so the second TC over here from Barus is basically going to allow him to just keep up with the production delta, right? With the Viper being able to produce 2 additional villages at a time compared to Barus. It's going to be the same with the 4 TC from the Viper, so like Barus is going to continue falling behind 4 villages a minute. I just don't see how Barus is ever able to come back over here. He does have the Mangonels coming forward. Technically, he's got 2. Yes, but these are completely unprotected. Okay, we have a Monk. That's good. Alright, so he's coming in. He's coming in with the Mangonels, and this finally might be what Barus needed to start pressuring the Viper. Nice conversion from Barus. But yeah, this is less than ideal, right? Having to send the Mangonels from so far away It's taken legit like 2 minutes for Barsa's units to get to Viper's base, and the Viper's already pulling an additional 8 villager lead because of it. Gonna be right back, but when I come back, I expect Viper will have this one in the back. Well, right now, it seems like the Viper is certainly the one in the lead this game by a lot. As a matter of fact, even if Varus got more military units, even if he's the one putting pressure over here, there's a lot for Varus to catch up for still. 40 TC and only 18 seconds of idle TC time? Well, that skyrocketed. That comment aged poorly, but yes, the Viper is still definitely the one and the lead over here, even if he's not able to keep on production going from all 4 TCs, and he's forced into playing a little bit more defensively over here, going for a few extra units, right? He still finds himself 19 workers ahead compared to Bar, so it's... yeah, still really, really good for the yellow player. Within control for the Viper, he's gotten one Magnol down already, one of the Skirmishers, he takes another Magnol down! As Barz queues another one from the Forest Siege Workshop he's recently built, the Viper is for the most part able to effectively clean this up. He's got the Scouts coming over to take on the Skirmishers, gotta be careful, there are Spearmen here. He's trying to target the Spearmen with the Skirmishers of his own, but we still have 3 left over here for the blue players. So the Viper does end up losing a bunch of the Scouts. But what's most important over here is the Viper was able to bring Barz's momentum over here to a halt. Barz, from this point onwards, he's got but one way to take this game, and that is to continue going for exactly what he's been going for over here, full push. And try to keep the mantles up, try to get the monks out, to get the conversions in. So he's got another monk over here coming out, but he's not really targeting the monks, the camel, sorry, with a new monk, and that is not the best unit to control, and this is exactly what happens. The Viper is not going to give you one bit of space to work with. You can see the damage over here. The blue player is actually achieving versus the yellow player is not enough. The Viper was able to repair the TC. Back up to 100 HP. Barz still has more military units compared to the Viper, but what will he do with those is the question. Not much. Another Magnol on the way. So far, I think Barz might have lost between 5-6 Magnols, probably. Be back now. Once again though, the Magnols are just expensive sacrifices Barz is going for, and the Viper is going to take them time and time again. Yeah, Magnol going down to the Skirmishers, and the Viper's getting a defensive castle up. And we know that he's getting this one up. He's got enough defensive units to guarantee the castle coming up. Meanwhile, Barz is collecting stone. He will try and make a play for a castle himself eventually, but right now the Viper is looking so good. Here we go. Cavalry MVP this game, like cavalry, the camels, Everything the Viper has gone for has worked out really, really well for him. And yeah, the Viper should actually have been able to click out to the Imperial Leech a while ago. I think it was missing a building. I don't know if he was waiting for the castle to come up or if he had to rush a university, perhaps. I think he might have had to rush a university, but he is on his way to the Imperial Leech Bars. But he should be able to click up himself very soon. However, the Viper should find himself in a much better position once he goes up. He's got a much higher military count. He's got a much stronger economy as well, with about 26 extra workers. Here we go. Defensive castle on the way for Bards, but the Viper's here with light cavalry. And while the castle's coming up, for sure. Now that the Viper knows about this, he'll know exactly where to strike. He'll know exactly where to go for the next castle. He's got almost enough resources for it. So we could expect to see another castle come out from the yellow player around here. As he goes out to the Imperial Leech, the hill advantage. It's gonna be fantastic, of course. Maybe somewhere like here will be a little bit better, so that he also has a little bit closer distance to here. Already two relics? Three relics right now, right? And Bars is going to collect one. And the Viper doesn't know about the relic up in the north. The amount of things that this player is able to keep up with is just mind-boggling. And it's not just a Viper, to be fair. Most players in the top 10, they're just going to be so good at keeping track of so many things at once. It's ridiculous. And yeah, the castle is coming up somewhat close to the stone over there. Not close enough that he'll be able to range it right away. Even with Bracer, right? But it's going to be close enough that it's kind of risky for Bards to collect from here. Regardless though, the Viper finds himself in the Imperial Leech earlier than Bards by about 50 seconds. So he should be able to start going for trebuchets. And interestingly enough, instead of going for the trebuchets right away from this castle, he's waiting for this castle to come up before going for the first one. Now, to be fair, he does not have enough wood to go for the trebuchets right now, but he's going for it now. He got it. As he was getting the second castle up, he got it. It's not going to be the huge head start, though, the trebuchet production that I thought he was going to get. Now, Bars, he's got his own trebuchet on the way. Yeah, but I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I am pretty sure the Bars' castle is a little bit lower elevation than the Viper, isn't it? I would actually have to enable the grid for 1 second. Where is the grid? Dude, it's been such a long time since the last time that I used this. I don't see the grid. Where is it? Casting? Grid? Dude, I cannot find it. Okay, whatever. Let's take a look. Ah, it seems to be alright. It seems like it's the same elevation. Trebuchet comes out now for Bars. Center, Viper's taking a monastery down from Bars, so the wool player was on one relic. He still has a relic garrison back home. This only has a monk instead. Oh, it is. Yeah, it is actually higher elevation. And Bars is taking a lot of damage over here. He's going to call the GG, and the Viper finds himself equalizing the series over here 1-1. In game number 3, of course. That one's going to take place on Bars' home map. That one's going to be Arena, so we'll see which civilizations we have left for the players to make use of over there. Remember that we had Bohemians for Bars, I think. And the Viper, didn't he have... I don't remember, actually. Let's go through the achievements before taking a look at the draft. Brickety for Bars, approaching 11-10. Economy, looking stronger for the Viper. For society, the Viper was the only player getting past 130 villagers. He did not lose a single villager throughout the game, while Bars took a bunch of losses. 11 villagers going down throughout the game. And there we are. Game 3 is here, guys. The final one of the second series. Bars 1. The Viper 1. Game number 3 is going to decide who takes the series. Who gets the 1 point of this set. Versus who takes one negative point, of course. And we'll have Bohemians for Bars. We'll have Turks for the Viper. We were expecting the Viper to go for Turks, given the choices he had. Turks seemed to be the better choice, right? He had Pulse and Turks. Turks seemed to be the better choice. Bars, or the safest choice. And Bars, he had Bohemians. He had Gurjaras. He decides to go for Bohemians. And yeah, taking a look at the civilization, starting with Bars is first. The Bohemians will grant him with free mining camp upgrades. He's gonna get 25% higher bonus damage from spearline units. In addition to a 100 wood discount and universities and the blacksmiths, we'll see that the Bohemians also get sanctity and fervor effect villagers. In addition to, what is the last one for the Bohemians? They get access to chemistry and hand cannoneer in the castle, right? Team bonus, on the other hand, for the Bohemians will be 80% faster working markets, while the Viper civilization, on the other hand, is gonna have a myriad of bonuses as well. Most of these very good for a map like Arena. First off, 25% faster working gold miners. He gets light cavalry and Hazar upgrades for free, in addition to one extra pierce armor on scoutline units, so those units are already going to be stronger from the get-go. Besides that, we see for Turks 25% higher HP on gunpowder units, free chemistry, a 50% discount on gunpowder upgrades, and it's gonna have, in addition to all of that, for the team bonus, 25% faster training gunpowder units. I feel like I'm missing one bonus for the Turks, so what is it? I might not be. Regardless, let's check the map generation for Bars first. And what do we get? We have a fantastic map for the bull players. Got the main gold on the back, secondary gold on the back as well. So none of these are going to be exposed. The berries are on the back. The main stone is on the back. Secondary gold. The remaining ones will be on the left-hand side up in the north beyond the walls, of course. And that's going to be about it. This is, yeah, one of the better arena map generations that I have seen. One thing that I do not really like too much about Bars is he does not seem to have quite as much surface area to work with compared to the Viper. Like, the Viper's base seems to be a little bit roomier. I don't know if this is actually the case. We have a mechanism by which I can try and figure that out. And let me check. I'm just going to draw a little bit of a frontier over here. This is a feature that I do not make use of very often, but is there. And this is 3,554 pixels long. 3,550. If we take a look at the Viper's map generation, on the other hand, let's take a look at the yellow player. Pardon my absolute lack of drawing skills. So it was 3550 for Bars. The Viper, on the other hand, give or take, 3520. And I think I actually kind of butchered this over here. It's probably like 3550 for both these players. Wow, that is like a really, really consistent map generation for both these guys. Damn, I wonder if they have in the script something for that. Anyway, Viper's resource location, in any case, it's gonna be not quite as good, though. He's got the main gold, the main stone on the left-hand side, kind of on the back, but the secondary gold on the right-hand side, it is significantly closer to the walls compared to any resource that Bars got access to, and because it's kind of close to this secondary gold outside and the secondary stone outside as well, if Bars was to scout this area, right? Like so. along the walls, he might actually get vision of this. As early as the field leech, I think. And this could be really good. If Barris is going to go for a cast drop at some point, and this is just all hypothetical, of course, he could very well decide to go for the castle over here if he got vision of the resources inside that way. He'd be able to deny all of this with a single fortification. That'd be really good, actually. PLH is gonna be here for both these players, and the Castle H is gonna be on the way as well in a moment. The Viper is going up on 24 population. And yeah, he's going for the barracks. Boss is not going for barracks over here. Seems like he's not gonna make a play for scouts. And the Viper is going to, with a free light cavalry upgrade he gets. It's definitely better for him to try and make a play for that. One thing we did not really take a look at too much, though, is the relic location. And what do we have for relics? Well, the Viper is going to have two relics. Yeah, sorry about that. Bitrate has gone down dramatically. It's going to pick back out. Don't worry about it. If you're watching this on YouTube, it's going to look better than it's looking on Twitch. I'm recording this locally as well, giving us how many woes we've had so far with the connection today. Sorry about that. It's not happened in a while, actually. We are not really having internet issues for too long. Or too frequently, anyway, but... Yeah, the Castle Leech is on the way for Bard significantly earlier compared to the Viper. The Viper is going after the Castle Leech, but he is not collecting any stones. So we won't see a castle come out for the Turks. We won't see Janissaries coming for the Turks. Let's head start the castle from Barris. Let's try and catch up over here. I did have to pause the game for a moment because of the bitrate issues. Yeah, and we are still having them. Unfortunately, you know what? I'm just going to restart the stream. All right, we should be live again. Do let me know if we have sound. We have sound, then we can just resume. If we don't, then I'm gonna have to restart the stream again. Are we live? Are we actually live? I don't know anymore. No? No sound? Ah, Twitch is so scuffed! God damn it. All All right, we are trying again. Do we have sound this time around? Let me know. Yes? Okay, let's go. Sorry about that. Once again, we're just gonna try to catch up, going 2x a little bit. Yeah, I know that today's stream is going to be kind of difficult to edit together for you too. So if you're watching this on YouTube and you're enjoying the series, guys, thumbs up, because it's been significantly more work to get this. Oh no, game over! Come on! Ah! Damn it. 15 minutes, 53 seconds, no problem. Yeah, I had to switch servers for OBS to work properly again, for Twitch to work properly again, and that means that the game lost internet connection for a moment, and then it stopped downloading the game data, so I need to restart it. No problem, though. 15 minutes, 53 seconds. It's okay. All the technical issues. What a mess. I know, right? You don't have to tell me. I'll be the one trying to make something passable out of this series when the stream is over and I have to edit it. Fifteen minutes and 53 seconds. We're fast forwarding. Three minutes into it. So one fifth of our way already. It's fine. After run of two, so I'm going to miss the clown map. Chinese New Year's Eve, so mom's cooking dumplings though. Is that, do you celebrate Chinese New Year? Is it always the same date every year or does it change? I am not too familiar with it. Like, is it always January 21st? Or 22nd rather? Taiwanese heritage. I see. Ah, okay. Right. All right. 12 minutes into it. We're catching up. We'll have to nip into the VOD. Yeah, or YouTube is probably going to be much easier. The VOD's going to be a disaster. It always changes. I see. All right. We are 15 minutes into the game. Let's go for it. Once again. And depends on the new moon in January or February, I see. All right. And we are back up. Sorry about all the downtime and all the different technical issues. We should be catching up over here. Once again, we are just going to stick to 2x until we eventually catch up. And let's bring the chat up. There we go, heavy plow coming in now. For the Viper bars. Scat wheelbarrow on the way. Both these players in the castle each have gone for extra TCs. Bars has got both these TCs up a little bit earlier compared to the Viper. The Viper, on the other hand, is gonna just try and make a play for economy over here. This is what we saw yesterday, and isn't this what we saw yesterday, actually? No, yesterday what we saw, it was Turks versus Bengalis, right? Yes, and I was talking about the possibility of just playing for economy with the Turks against Bengalis. Might have been riskier over here against the Bohemians. The Viper is going to feel comfortable enough to give it a shot anyway. But so far, Bars has gotten the better end of the deal. He's got a higher work count by about 8. The Viper is trying to get the 4 DC up. Bars, he's got enough stone to go for a castle, but yeah, that'll be about it. Let me take a look at the scouting information. The relics, by the way, are being all collected by the Viper. There is no center presence to speak of from Varus. As a matter of fact, he doesn't even have a monk out. He's going for the first one. He lost a scout already. And taking a look at this scout information, he knows about this. This is what I was talking about earlier. If Varus is the one to go for full pressure forward and drops a castle outside the walls, by the walls over here, he should be in a position to deny three resource with a single fortification. However, he's going for a defensive castle first. We could see a forward castle be the case for the second one instead. Imperial is on the way for Varus. Interestingly enough, despite the 4TC from the Viper, and while the yellow player is catching up, Varus is going out to the Imperial Age earlier. Pyrex of Sturx is scary. Yeah, map control of Sturx is fantastic as well. It's gonna have access to all the neutral goals. It's gonna have access even to Varus' secondary goal over here, given the castle does not have enough range to protect this one. Or the knight, in any case, right? Yeah, not even close. Would Bracer? Maybe. Another 1 minute head start on the Viper. The Imperial Age time for Varus, yes. The Viper's going for Janissaries, and Varus is going for a forward castle. But he cannot go for the castle in the location I was talking about earlier, because the Viper already has a defensive castle over here himself. He's got a second castle coming up as well. So that's good. At the very least, Viper should be able to secure this gold. Although, of course, it's technically possible for Varus to try and castle drop the Viper over here. That would still be beyond the range of Viper's defensive castles, and he would still be able to deny this one. So now I do have to run up. Just in time for the big imp battle. Enjoy all. Bye now. Bye Flash Club. Alright. I'll see you next time, Wonder Boy. Always enjoy reading your YouTube comments, by the way. Beautiful. The Viper. Yes, sir. He's got artillery already. Meanwhile, Varus has gone for Wiggenberg tactics. He's got Humnitsa coming up. We're still trying to catch up over here. Might not continue 2xing over here for much longer. And it is the case that we have caught up, so I do not even need to go back to 1x. The game has already completely caught up. So we are effectively live right now. As live as we can be, anyway. Varus. Taking the castle down. Yes, sir. The Viper. Pushing. Varus away. All players left and only one castle over here. Meanwhile, the Viper. The Viper's coming in with a bunch of Bombard Cannons. Humnitsa are stronger than Bombard Cannons over here. However, they are not going to be anywhere near as much range. Well, it's just going to be one difference, right? But if you play your cards right, your artillery Bombard Cannons I actually outtrade the Humnitsa, right? We see one going down right there to the Janissaries. Well done. Yes. And the Viper's going for more and more Bombard Cannons. He's got 6 already out. He's going for 3 more. Varus is going for 1 additional Humnitsa. He's got half as many as the Viper. And it's looking really, really good for the yellow player. Although, we see a Bombard Cannon go down. There is another Humnitsa dying. On the right-hand side. There we go. Really smart to bombard, try to bombard Cannon Micro against one of the best. Kinda have to, right? Varus doesn't really have too many options over here with the civilization. Best shot taking the Bombard Cannons over here from the Viper. It's going to be his own Humnitsa, but of course, much easier said than done. So far, the Viper has gotten a much, much better trade. It's got 7 Bombard Cannons left with the Teary. 1 extra range compared to the Humnitsa, and we have no Humnitsa anymore left for Barz. He lost them all. He's got 1 over here, actually left. I should correct myself. But it's going down! That is too close! The Viper in control has been great, though. And he's going after the last one. Not quite. He's just trying to hold on against the Halberdier for the time being. The Halberdier going down to the Janissaries. And the Viper's Bombard Cannon push over here is still looking fantastic. 8 Bombard Cannons already for the yellow player. He doesn't have any more on the way. Barz. Yeah, Barz on the other hand, he's got 1 Humnitsa and he's trying to make a play for Hand Cannoneer himself. That it's not going to be enough. The Janissaries are so much better. The Viper, he has got an elite Janissary already, so these units are as good as they can be. Good Humnitsa shot. However, the Viper is coming in now. The unit control. Here we are, up in the north, there's a defensive castle attempt from Barz, but here comes the Viper, and Barz is pushed back into his walls, and the Bombard Cannons from the Viper are incredible! Getting so much damage done! We still have all 8 alive, taking the castle down, and Barz is on a single Humnitsa over here. The Viper's gonna try to snipe as well, of course, and he will end up losing 1 Bombard Cannon himself. And the Humnitsa is still very much alive. If Barz plays his cards right, might be able to get some good damage done. However, Viper's prediction and attack round allows him to chunk over half HP of that Humnitsa already. Viper left the 2 Bombard Cannons. He's been losing a lot to the Halberdier, actually. And these guys, a Halberdier from Barz, they get 25% higher bonus damage, but I'm not really sure actually they have bonus damage against Siege, do they? They don't. They don't, they're just strong. Here we are. Viper's going for more Bombard Cannons once again. Barz this time around has managed to push the Viper out for the time being. He's managed to catch up the population. Yeah, there we are, and the Viper. The Viper's actually starting to take a few too many levels over here. The Janissaries are not looking that strong anymore, and the Viper is trying to make a play for Huzzar against Bohemian Halberdier. This surely cannot work, can it? Bombard Cannons going down to the Halberdier once again is just a testament to the power of Barz's units. 2 units going down right away, and we're gonna see another Bombard Cannon going down. So the Viper starting to lose the grip on this game as Barz managed to get the castle up in the north. It's got another castle coming up. The center of the map. Yeah, and Barz deletes the castle foundation over here. Still enough stone for both these players to go for extra castles. And Barz is starting to build some momentum. I think he lost it this one, Barz. Did he? Seems like not. No, no. He deleted it. Yeah. That was very close though. That could very well have been a lost castle. Beautiful. This is trying to get the castle up himself. One more time, the Viper's gonna try and siege it down. Embarrass might be forced into deleting it the second time. Probably not. Actually, you know what? There's only one villager over there from Bards! And the castle! The castle needs to get deleted! 56%! Only two villagers over there against three Bombard cannons. Is not good. He does bring his own Hubnito over though, so the Bombard cannons from the Viper are not just focusing on the castle anymore. There we are. Beautiful. The Viper is able to hold on over here. Takes the vast majority of Bars' units out. But Bars has already gained momentum. Up in the north, he's trying to trebuchet the castle down from the Viper. Down the south, he's got a Halberdier coming over still. He's got to be careful, of course. The Janissaries do not really care about the Halberdier too much. The Hubnita. The Hubnita need to be micro, extremely careful in order to not go down to the Bombard cannons, to the artillery Bombard cannons from the Viper, in addition to being able to take down the Janissaries as well if he plays his cards right. We're getting to healthy numbers of Bombard cannons for the Viper again. Bars. Up in the north, being raided by Hussar. Some of the villages go down, but the Halberdier do manage to clean these units up, and the Viper is going to keep on trying to go for more raids, though. This should not be too effective. Bars is going to keep on getting Hussar by the minute out of the barracks over there. However, the castle at the center does crumble on the Viper. The Viper is going to start pushing once again. He's on 7 Bombard cannons, artillery ones. Bars, he's got 3 Hubnita. He's got another one on the way. Trying to defend himself up in the north, and he loses grip of the game down the south. Bombard tower makes sense for the Viper? I would say probably not. Against the Hubnita, I would say no. Especially given the current resource situation, the Viper seems like he has lost access to any extra gold. If we take a look at the amount of resources left, there's only one gold available up in the north. The Bars is collecting from and is going to run out in the next few minutes. Well, you know what? Maybe once the gold runs out, he's got 5 relics, right? Maybe it would actually make sense for him. But the thing is, Bombard Towers at this stage doesn't really secure much of anything from the Viper. It just prevents potential raids, for instance. But he is the one trying to push over here, so he will only secure some extra ground to work with, but he wouldn't be able to do too much with it, right? Like, there is no gold left. Sadly, the tech itself costs both gold and stone. Right. Yeah, maybe it would have been something for him to go for when he originally had momentum earlier into the game, the first time that he was pushing before he got pushed back. Maybe in that situation, perhaps it would have made sense when there was still resources available around the map. Right now, doesn't seem so. Yeah, the Viper's struggling right now to keep the Bombard cannons alive. Bars. He's done a good job with the Hubnita. He still has 3 left. And the Viper has officially run out of gold, guys. Bars is going to himself very soon as well. And the Viper's coming over. Here we go. Two more bombard cannons going down from the Viper. The unit control from Pirates has been pretty good overall. It's gonna be the only player left with any bombards over here. The one who needs to left from Pirates. The Viper, he's got more coming up by the minute as well. And the relics over here are coming in extremely clutch from the Viper. Barros, once he effectively runs out of gold over here, he won't really be able to keep on going for units the same way the Viper's been able to go for. Viper's composition is double as heavy on gold though. Relic seem to favor Viper though. He can trade cannon for cannon and eventually make more. Yes, there is a point though. The Janissaries over here are very pricey, but he's trying to also add a little bit of padding to that army by going for a meat shield of Hazar. So long as he's able to keep like the units from Barras at bay, either skirmishers or halberdier, then the Janissaries are going to take care of the units. But we just gotta be careful not to go head on against the halberdier, of course, with the Hazar. He's doing a good job for the most part. Barras is impressive. Is it like 2k4 now? You can find out very easily by doing exclamation mark elo space Barras. Alternatively, you can do hashtag Barras as well. I believe that command should be tracking Barras as well. But yeah, that was not the best engagement. This is what I was talking about. He's going to head on against the halberdier, the Viper that is, with Hazar. So quite clearly, he was going to get cleaned up. And he did. And interestingly enough, the yellow player is still on a much higher population compared to Barras. And the blue player is holding on over here, but he is not in the best position still. 2k5, rank 16. Damn, Barras has been grinding. Hitting the ranks. Here we go. Militia dead. And the Viper is still getting some extra gold over here. You can see that's not the case for Barras at all. And check this out, guys. If we take a look at a market, you'll see the selling prices. You can sell some food and get some gold out of it, but wood's already pretty much bottomed out. Stone, you can sell some stone, but Barras does not really have too much of it. Less than 500. And yeah, he's not going to want to keep on going anymore, and he's going to call it a GG. Now, the Viper certainly was the player with momentum over here. Although, Barras was able to hold on over there for significantly longer than I thought he was going to. Earlier, when we saw the Viper first make the push in the Imperial Age with 8 freaking bombard cannons, it was looking like the game was going to be quite clearly going in favor of the Viper, but then Barras was able to stall the push quite a lot. All right, he was able to fend Viper's units off and yeah, stole the game right a little bit in the end. Viper doesn't that take this one, but it was not without a fight. Barras is going to go down by 1 point on the standings, and the Viper on the other hand is going to be 2-1 up over here, which is going to give him a point. And we'll take a look at what the group is looking like after taking a look at the achievements first. Very good KD for the Viper, for as long as we were able to spectate this using Capture Reach. For economy, we have a stronger economy for the Viper as well, collecting about 14,000 extra resources, close to it, not quite as much. And for society, a much higher villager max count for the Viper, maybe not much higher villager max count for the Viper, but he was certainly the one to lose the least villagers. He got a higher villager max count, he ended up losing 27 villagers. Well, if you take a look at Barras's economy on the other hand, he ended up losing 57 himself, so significantly more losses for the bull player. This was going to continue going in favor of the Viper further and further. The longer the game went, it was going to be a little bit of a landslide. So Barras recognizes it, calls it GG, and Viper's going to be up 2-1 after the second series of the day.